everybody. I'm Mike.
I'm Matt.
Armchair Directors.
What I want from each and every one of you is a hard targeted search of every gas station, residence, warehouse, farmhouse, hen house, outhouse, and doghouse in that area. Checkpoints go up at 15 miles. Your fugitive's name is Dr. Richard Kimball.
Give that man an Oscar. That was awesome.
Go get him.
Taking a look at Fugitive, a classic. Man, makes me feel old to call that a classic, because it does feel like that just came out a few years ago, didn't it?
Yeah, just a few years ago. 26 years ago.
Oh,
unbelievable.
My Lord. But such a great Harrison Ford movie. Kind of gets lost in the shuffle when you think of the great Star Wars and Indiana Jones. But such a great movie based on a TV show. Some people forget that. And incredibly faithful to the TV show, right down to the theme.
Right.
Which kind of is out of place in the movie. Like, it keeps coming up and coming up. And I remember commenting when I was watching it, that's the TV show theme. Like, whoever made this movie really loved the TV show, and they weren't into this reimagining, put my own spin on it. No, this is the show with Kimball and the one-armed man. Really cool.
Yeah, I still, watching it again after all these years, it's still just a great thriller. And they do embrace all the aspects that made the show very popular, including the theme. Now, James Newton Howard does the score, and a lot of times when he actually gets into the original stuff is where the movie really excels, and I just love the main themes. And the thing that makes this work the best is that you've got Harrison Ford, who we all love, and you're rooting for him, but also Tommy Lee Jones is so good. And he's smart, and he's not an idiot, and you actually are rooting for him, too, the whole movie.
Weird dynamic. So weird dynamic.
It's a thing where we got two heroes, because you love Richard Kimball, but you also like Samuel Gerard just as much. And it's not a cat and mouse where we want Gerard to succeed, but we want him to somehow come around and see the light and the truth that we know, because we're in on it with the flashbacks. We know Harrison Ford couldn't possibly have done this.
Yeah,
and that's
the U.S. Marshals,
thing.
Too. It's not like there are some jerk marshals, too, that are like, he's got a higher up that's a pain in the butt, or some of his underlings, or like, all the marshals are great, too. And we don't even know who the villain is for most of this movie.
Right.
So we've got heroes, and we're like, who do we hate here? We hate the one-armed man, but who is he? Where is he?
Yeah.
So it really had that dynamic, that mystery dynamic of the TV show. And I just love how smart Kimball is in this movie. He's so brilliant. He uses his brilliance in practical ways in order to evade the authorities, while he's also trying to solve the case that all of these so-called experts failed miserably at solving. So that was another really compelling part. He wasn't just run, run, don't get caught, but using his wits and just nonchalantly strolling through a hospital while he's the most wanted man in America, and helping people while he's doing it. The movie's also peppered with all these beautiful moments of Richard Kimball reminding us why he's not guilty, why he couldn't have done this, why he's a decent human being. He's saving lives left and right, even though everyone's trying to catch him and throw him back in jail.
Yeah, it's that Hippocratic oath that the doctors take. It's always calling out to him, like, he's got to help the greater good and do no harm. And that is part of the fun of it. And also, because he was sentenced to lethal injection, he is a guy who literally has nothing to lose while he's on the run. So he does take bold choices of going to all of these places where normally a guy like Harrison Ford would stick out quite a bit. And they go to great lengths to show us how he's evading people. But you buy into it because you want him to succeed. The whole time you're just rooting for him. And I do like that the script gives us enough of the events of the evening without hitting us over the head about what happened. It's only, you know, 40 minutes in until we actually see the one-armed man, because they play it slow by revealing a little bit more and a little bit more. And then as Kimball himself starts to unravel the mystery, we get drawn in and we're intrigued. And like you said, we're not sure who the actual bad guy of the movie is until that final twist. But it's also the kind of movie that now, 26 years later, when you watch it and you already know all the twists and turns, it's still just as entertaining and just as fun to watch, because you've got such a good cast having a great time on this gigantic thrill ride.
Yeah, really rewatchable. Already have seen it a couple of times, know what's going to happen. But it's one of those movies where it still can surprise you even if you know what's coming up. It's written, edited in a way that you're not like, okay, here's the part where this happens and here's the part where that happens. And I really like how the movie starts off with the deed has already been done. Mm-hmm. So we don't have to sit through 15 minutes of going to these ritzy, hoity-toity parties and watching Kimball be unlikable. You know, like we're spared anything of his life before this happened. We're introduced to him when he's already become this, you know, this has just happened and he's answering these cop questions and these cops are insufferable, you know, asking him these insensitive questions. Right. And he's like looking at them and going, what is wrong with you? Mm-hmm. And he's trying to, you know, appeal to their humanity, which they don't have any, those particular ones in charge of that. So just really, really smartly done movie. Really enjoyed it.
Yeah, and it's written by Jeb Stuart, who was a co-writer on Die Hard and a bunch of other like late 80s, early 90s actioners.
So that was obvious to me because of all of Kimball's great one-liners.
So he's really good.
No, he didn't have any.
And the other screenwriter is David Toohey, best known for Pitch Black and Riddick. And
yeah.
So like smart guys wrote this movie and you can see that they revere the source material. And while Ford and Tommy Lee Jones are like the main guys, we actually got a pretty solid cast because even the U.S. Marshals like Joey Pants, we like a lot of these people who are helping Tommy Lee Jones. And then you've got some people before they were quite big, like Julianne Moore, Jane Lynch from Glee, popping up in like small roles that now you're like, oh, hey, look, it's these people. But they're actually just solid performances. And everybody remembers, you know, whenever I hear anything about pharmaceutical companies being crooked, I always think of Devlin McGregor and The Fugitive. And I'm like, of course, they're all assholes. Like when the doors are closed, pharmaceutical companies aren't trying to help us. They're trying to kill us because The Fugitive told me so.
Absolutely. All right. Best part.
Worst part. Best part, Harrison Ford and Tommy Lee Jones. Like I said earlier, the fact that it is a game of cat and mouse, but neither of them are the villain and we're rooting for both and they're both just as smart as the other guy is what makes this movie so much fun because it's rare that we have people who can go toe-to-toe like that and neither of them are wrong. Neither of them are in the wrong.
And neither of them are a-holes. Like when Tommy Lee takes that shot to save his marshal and he, you know, probably causes permanent ear damage, he could have really cut that kid down and busted his chops. And, you know, the kid's already suffering. Mm-hmm. But Sam consoles him, you know, and that was a really surprising scene to me. I thought he was going to bark at him and blah, 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 I need to do my job. Right. But instead, he's very tender with the kid. It almost seems uncharacteristic, but he keeps doing that. He really cares about his men, even though he doesn't care about what Kimball's motivation is. So I really enjoyed the fact that this guy who should have been McGee from The Incredible Hulk is just as likable to me as Kimball is.
Yeah. Worst part is tough to pick just because I really do enjoy this, but there are a few like movie cliche moments that pull me out of it a little bit. Like when they go undercover as like the homeless guys to do the raid on the other escapee.
Wait till you see U.S. Marshals again.
And those are like, these are like movie moments that I don't think necessarily would happen in real life. And where Tommy Lee takes the other guy out and the other guy, his buddy is like, but you could have shot me. Why didn't you bargain? He's like, I don't bargain. Wink at the camera, like thumbs up movie moment. I'm just like.
It was done so well though. It was a whisper. No.
And it's true, but it's one of those things where like I care so much more about the Kimball storyline that these things just feel like the added action cliches we have thrown in so that we won't get bored while Harrison Ford's just sifting through old files and pictures.
And that really gets proven in U.S. Marshals, which is The Fugitive without Harrison Ford.
Right.
Worst part for me, the climax when he walks into the big banquet hall during the big speech. And he waves the Ford finger and he tells the guy, you're a bad man. You're behind all this. And the guy's like, oh, no. and he's done for. Right. His goose is cooked. Stick a fork in him. He's done. Because this guy walked in, this fugitive, this convicted murderer, walked in waving his finger, and this guy doesn't have a hope in hell of getting out of this situation because this guy is making these allegations. Right. He doesn't, and he runs. He runs. So I love the movie, but that always cracks me up that this, I got to get the heck out of here.
Yeah. Especially in a room with so many people, he would have definitely been better off to just have a confrontation out in public and wait till the authorities got there. Cause yeah, that is a little bit of a ridiculous moment. And then that guy goes full movie villain in the course of like 4 minutes from 0 to 100.
Yeah. Like, where's the security taking Kimball debt? Was there no security in the room filled with millionaires?
Right.
And maybe a couple billionaires?
Yeah.
With a convicted killer. All right. Best part, I didn't kill my wife. I don't care. Sploosh.
Yeah. So good.
Love that. Favorite part in the whole movie. One of the most memorable movie scenes ever for me. And that just says it all about the whole cat and mouse chase. It's nothing personal. Mm. I'm not angry at you because you killed your wife. It's my job to catch you. And that's admirable. The guy's just doing his job. It's nothing personal. And Kimball will risk his life for justice, not just to save his own butt, but to avenge his wife, get some justice for her too. So yeah, best part in the tunnel.
Oh yes. That whole tunnel sequence is dynamite. So good. Yeah. Where'd he go? He did a Peter Pan off of this thing. Like, I can't believe it. So definitely, if you haven't seen The Fugitive in a long time, or if you were born after it came out and just have never seen it, track it down. It's great.
Yeah. And there is a follow-up sort of movie they made called U.S. Marshals. Now, I wasn't aware of this for a few years. I had heard of U.S. Marshals, and I saw Tommy Lee on the poster. I didn't realize he's Sam Gerard from U.S. Marshals, and the whole team is back. Mm-hmm. So I tried to watch it when it first came out, a couple of years after it came out, and I couldn't get into it at the time because I like Wesley Snipes, but you don't replace Harrison Ford with Wesley Snipes, and it was a total different dynamic too. It wasn't an intellectual on the run fugitive. It was like a punch and kick explosions on the run fugitive. But if you do want to check out U.S. Marshals, if you really love Sam Gerard and his Marshals, and you just want a little bit more, you got to do it back to back. That's how I got through U.S. Marshals. As soon as Fugitive is done, you put in U.S. Marshals, and it's like a minute hasn't passed. If you can get past the chicken outfit, a little more undercover stuff going on, and Tommy Lee in yellow nylons, if you can get past that, it's, you know, it's more of Sam Gerard, which is not a bad thing at all.
I saw it in the theater and I thought it was very entertaining. Not, you don't have Ford, so it's not as good, but I'm gonna give that a rewatch soon. You'll probably see a review of U.S. Marshals coming up very shortly.
Yep. And if you're on a real Tommy Lee kick, because I got on one after watching The Fugitive, I hunted down this old movie called The Park Is Mine from like 85 or 86.
Okay.
It takes place in Brooklyn, and it's about Tommy Lee, who's a Vietnam vet, taking over Central Park. It's his. He takes it over because he wants, well, you got to watch the movie to get his real motivation, but it was about respect for veterans. It's filmed in Toronto. It couldn't be more Canadian. Every Canadian you know is in this thing. The Polkaroo was in this thing. the guy who was in the Polkaroo outfit. Like, every Canadian you could think of is in this movie. But Tommy Lee is awesome in it. And it's actually a really fun movie, too. So I recommend that one as well.
I've never heard of it, so I will track it down.
Thanks a lot for watching, and until next time.
Enjoy the show.